much, everyone, for coming. I see a lot of familiar faces. I'm super happy to see you. And all of the newcomers, welcome. Super happy to have you as well. My name is Casey Luck. I do too many things. I run a blog about email marketing, and I also do growth marketing at a company called Hack Temple. We have some customers and some team members here, so that's exciting. So I also do this just as a side project because I like bringing people together, and normally these talks are about email marketing. This one is a little bit different. It's still about email, and there's a lot of copywriting in it, so it will be good for both marketers and sales and business development people. So, and Heather is amazing, so it's going to be good for anybody. I wanted to thank our partners tonight. First of all, Galvanize, who provides this amazing venue. Thanks so much, Galvanize team. Also, Alex with Thunder Films, who is right there and right there, who's recording this talk. He also does video for startups, things like brand stories and customer testimonial and things like that. So talk to him if you're interested in that. And also our special partner tonight, LeadIQ, which is a company that helps you with sales prospecting and makes the process much faster and easier, finding contacts and their emails and all the additional information. Heather Morgan runs SalesFog, and I first got introduced to Heather when I took her online course, which got recommended to me by a friend, and I was blown away by the content, and I realized I had no clue about how to write cold emails before this. So I'm super excited that she'll be talking to you guys tonight, and I'm sure you all learned a lot of cool stuff.
Can everyone hear me okay? I think so. Oops. Okay, so how many people here write cold emails as part of their work? Show of hands. Great, I'm with the right people. Okay, so really briefly, a little bit about myself, who I am. I'm an ex-economist. Oh, can you not? Okay, louder? Okay. So a little bit about myself. I am a former economist. I used to work with organizations like World Bank. I was in North Africa after Arab Spring, and I decided to move back to the US and do something totally different. However, I've been writing forever, and I've been sending cold emails, at least sending one a day, for more than 10 years now. So I've definitely written more than 10,000 cold emails, and since starting my company, which helps B2B sales organizations write cold emails, we've helped more than 350 companies scale their outbound email efforts with highly personalized templates that can be sent to hundreds, thousands, or even more people to get new customers. So what I'm going to be talking about today is how to craft that email to get your first 100 customers. The same advice applies also if you're trying to scale up your outbound efforts. And then let's take it from there. So how do you get customers? There's a lot of different ways. Maybe intros, especially, let me take it back a second. So if you're a startup and you have no name and you have no connections, what do? How do you get new customers? So when I moved back from the US, I worked for a small startup company that was just in 500 startups. The founder was from Jordan. It was his first time in America, and it was a mobile games company. My job was to do business development to set up partnerships with C-suite executives in the gaming industry. However, I knew no one in games, and I hadn't been in America in 4 years. So how do I do this? I don't even know anything about games. So I thought to myself I would do what I've done whenever I move to a new country or change jobs. I would just put together a list of prospects and start doing mail merges. And so I put together a couple CSVs of contacts in the gaming industry based on the criteria I needed to target. And within a couple weeks, I had about a 67-68% response rate. And I was getting meetings with people like the founder of Guitar Hero, and my boss was like, holy crap, what are you doing? Are you getting intros? no, I don't know anyone who's going to introduce me. And so word got around pretty quickly in 500 what I was doing. Word got around pretty quickly what I was doing, and people started trying to poach me. But I had been doing freelance writing on the side for 7-8 years at that point, and I thought to myself, rather than have a divorce, why not have an affair? So I really quickly lined up 6-7 companies that gave me job offers, and I turned them into my first clients before I even left 500. And so when the company was relocating, that's when I decided to just go and do my own thing full time. And so since then, I mean, initially I had those 6-7 customers, but how did I grow? Outbound. So pretty much, other than a few referrals here and there, most of our first 100 customers came from outbound email. Since then, we've gotten more referrals and inbound and everything else, but most of our first 100 customers, aside from the first handful, were all from outbound. So what I want to explain today is exactly how you can do that without a network, without content marketing, even though I do like content marketing, but you can't always wait for that, and without doing any cold calling at all, because I mean, it depends on your audience, but cold calling is becoming less and less effective, and likewise, it's not scalable the same way email is. It has a much higher cost, an opportunity cost. So, how do you get customers? Let's talk about the magic of cold email. So there's 5 main steps I like to think about. The first one involves thinking about who your audience is. And so writing to a CEO is totally different than writing to a CTO, totally different than writing to yoga instructors. And a CEO of a huge company is completely different than a CEO of a small startup. So you have to think, who is your audience, and how do you do that? You need to understand them. It's great to talk to people, but for starters, I like to do what I call e-stalking. So how do you do that? I like to do it by going on LinkedIn. Twitter works too if they're on Twitter, anywhere they are. You want to learn as much as you can about them. And not everyone in your audience, just need a sample. So define the buyer persona that you're going after. It could be based on title, it could be based on industry size, it could be based on company size, industry, whatever firmographic criteria you have to build your list should be the exact same criteria you are using when you are thinking about writing cold emails. And so do a search. Look at about a dozen LinkedIn profiles that you would actually be targeting. And from that, you can build a composite, thinking about what keywords to use, thinking about what tone to use, what these people are afraid of, what keeps them up at night, what would get them fired, what would get them the promotion or lose it, who influences them, who do they trust, what content are they sharing on social, how are they talking about it. Once you think of all these things, it becomes a lot easier. And a little pro tip for LinkedIn is to look on their references, who they're referring and who has referred them, because those are actually really rich with keywords and gives you a good sense of how they talk about their colleagues and how their colleagues talk about them. Especially on some profiles where the introduction is blank and there's nothing other than just their title. So that's a good place to look. Looking at their keywords is good too. And I already kind of went over this, but high level, you really want to think about what their KPIs are and what are the pain points that your product or service will be solving. And another way you can do it is to look at your own customers, if you have them, and think about how you made them successful before. What were their problems? How did you add value? And you can also look at job posts if you want to look at KPIs for that specific audience. That's another really good indicator of what they will be evaluated on and what they care about. So the second rule of cold email is to be enticing. This is where you need to think and use your research that you have done to try to figure out how to appeal to your prospects. Because boring emails are bullshit and they don't work. So how do you do this? So once you have this information, I'm gonna assume you already know your prospects' pain points, what they care about. you need to think about your product or your solution or service in terms of benefits, not features. Features are flat and boring. Benefits are enticing and alluring. And so a very simple way to think about your product's benefits or your service's benefits is how it would add value to the customer. So for example, our cars are fast is a feature, whereas a benefit would be something like you can drive twice as fast in our car. Likewise, to say we have low prices is not compelling, whereas if you say you'll save $399 a year in auto insurance with us, that's more of a benefit, just for example. And so if you look at sales folks' features as an actual example, what do? We write cold emails. That says what we do, but it's not persuasive. If we want it to be persuasive, we have to say something that our audience would care about. So if we're talking to VP sales, we need to say something like, we help you start conversations with your future customers. Or instead of saying, we optimize email campaigns, which we do, it's much more persuasive to say something like, we can get you 3x more responses from qualified leads, or we can 3x your revenue, for example. Rule number 3, show, don't tell. I see this one a lot. Rather than talking about yourself or all your features, one of the most compelling and credible things you can do is to let your customer success brag for you. What I mean by this is building social proof into your emails. And so I'm going to be tearing apart some emails you guys sent me before, semi-anonymously at the end. And you'll see one of the recurring issues in there is a lack of social proof. And social proof isn't necessarily just saying the name of the company that you have helped or the names of companies. The best social proof paints a picture that elicits emotion as to what it would be like to be your customer. What kind of value will people get if they're your customer? What are the results? What are the examples of ROI? And so the more you can give specific details as to the kind of value you can add and the kind of problems you solve, the better it will be. And the more tangible these examples are, the better. And so, for example, rather than saying, oh, I cut this in 50%, which I see people do, say I cut it in half. 300 minutes is 5 hours, things like that. And the other thing you need to keep in mind is that your social proof needs to seem credible. There was an email, I think it was from Marketo, that I tore apart on NBC last year. And it said something about like increasing numbers by 4,000%. Even if it's true, it doesn't sound believable. It sounds like bullshit. So you need to think what sounds realistic. Even if you can 20x people's results, maybe don't say that. Think about what seems real and possible, maybe 3x, maybe 10x. I don't know. It depends on your audience, but you need to put it in terms that make sense. And even with something like 3x, it's better when you can say, we took them from here to there to paint that picture. So I'm gonna have some water for a second. Oh, perfect, even better. Even easier to open. I drink a lot of water. So here are a few examples of social proof from real emails. And I'm just gonna read them really quickly and we can talk about them. So the first one is, we cut client X's hiring time in half from an average of 21 days to 9 or less by allowing them to screen potential hires more conveniently with video interviews. So see how clear and tangible that is. It's not a percent. They painted a picture. The second one says, before working with us, client X was wasting $690,800 a quarter on unnecessary printing costs. We were able to help them eliminate these costs while backing up all their file type, whatever, that was like custom insert, documents in one central location. So you see the benefit of a very specific, tangible number that sounds too specific to be made up. Sounds definitely real. Even if it was made up, you would, as a reader, assume it was real in most cases because it's so specific. And you can imagine this whole journey. It's telling a story. It's painting a picture in your head. And then the third one is, clients' customers were getting annoyed and disappointed because client X kept sending them dynamic creative ads that were featuring products that were actually out of stock. Using our auction software, client X's dynamic ads now automatically check their inventory in real time to avoid losing their customers' trust. So that third one is a little bit like jargony, but the audience it was going to was, I think it was something in ad tech where that would have been appropriate. But you can see how it's sort of painting a picture. That one isn't the best one though. Rule number four. There's one more rule left. Rule number four is to stay laser focused. You need to only focus on one concept per cold email. This is really important in copywriting, all kinds of copywriting, web copy, email marketing, cold emails, blog posts. It's really important to have one concept. So, I mean, in a blog post, you could have like multiple things under one umbrella, but you need a clear theme. And with cold emails, the more simple your email is, the better it can be. And if you ask yourself, well, I have so many benefits and things to focus on, that's great, because you need to write 8 cold emails if you want to optimize your chances of getting a response, because 1/3 of your responses, statistically speaking, will usually come from between emails 5 and 8. So if you're only sending 2 emails, you're probably missing 50 or 60% of your possible responses, because people are busy, shit gets lost in their inbox, and they might not see it. Also, to put everything in one email, in one subject line, you're putting all your eggs in one basket. And so that's another reason why I never do the re-subject line emails, almost never. There's a few cases where your open to response rate ratio makes sense where you should do that. Most cases, it's better to have a new subject line because let's say most cold emails are getting 50% less their open rate. Some get much higher, but most of them, let's say, hope to get 50%. If that is the case, that means half of your list did not see what you just sent. So keep doing that again and again with the same subject line versus new ones that are drastically different, that are focusing on different pain points, benefits, or ideas. Increase your odds of applying to the diversity of your audience. So even if you're focused on a really narrow audience, having a variety of things will increase your odds because different people care about different things, and also it's a way for you to test out different things. It's not exactly an A/B test. It's not perfect that way, but you can start to see like local maxima and minima, what's working, what's not. You have to be careful about false positives and false negatives where like, we had one campaign where email 6 for our client performed really well. And they thought, oh, we shouldn't move that to like email 1 or 2. And it didn't work as well. And my theory with that was email 5 was sent right around the holidays and no one saw it. Email 5 was actually the really good email. Email 6 was seen after everyone came back from vacation. So there's little things like that where the data isn't necessarily perfect, but let me talk again about focus and why it's important and show you this email. So this is an email that got a number of new clients for one of our customers. And you'll see above that I wrote the focus or the benefit. And the idea is screen more qualified candidates more quickly through some kind of innovative competition. And I always write the focus above my emails when I'm writing them in a doc, because it helps me when I'm reviewing and editing them read and decide if it's lost focus. And that focus could be a pain point, could be a benefit, it could be a concept, but it needs a really tight focus. And so I'll read this really quickly. Subject is online competition for company job applicants. It says, hi first. I have an idea for an online competition that can help you quickly attract and spot the most qualified candidates from hundreds of applications. The same concept helped client X, and that I think was a competitor in many cases. Well, no, that was static because it had a specific number. Screen more than 290 job candidates and find their hire in only 10 days. when do you have 10 minutes to hear how this idea could work for a company? So this is kind of an old email. The I have an idea thing has been used a lot more now, and it's not as effective as it used to be because I've written a few posts on it and it's kind of taking off, and I'm seeing it in my own inbox now with cold emails. So that's another important point I want to bring up before going to rule number 5. A number of people asked me, like, and with this, with some of the questions, and in general, I'm always asked, what's your winning email template? Or like, what's the best subject line? Or what's the best blah, blah, blah template? There's no such thing. Anything that worked really well can die if people know about it or if something changes. There's no such thing as the winning solution, because what works today could stop working tomorrow. And the second all your competitors start doing the same thing, or someone writes a blog post about it and everyone starts doing that, it will die. So you can't think that way. You have to keep constantly testing new things. You have to think about your audience. You have to think about what your competition is doing and everyone else in that space. So before I'm about to mention rule number 5, there's something I want to bring up. If you look in your inbox, how many emails do you have from marketers that are capitalizing every word in your subject line? I bet more than a dozen in the last 100. That said, don't capitalize every word in your subject line because it looks like a mass marketing email and people don't open it. So you notice no words in our subject lines are capitalized besides proper nouns. Maybe that'll change someday. Maybe everyone will stop capitalizing and we'll start again. But it does look kind of tacky. And this looks like it was written on my phone more likely than something where I capitalized every word and I wrote it ahead of time. So rule 5, the last rule before we get into some examples, is evoke emotions. So you want to replace boring buzzwords with enticing details. And so that, again, kind of ties back to replacing your features with benefits and thinking about specific emotions such as fear, surprise, joy, etc. And one thing that you can do is to use rich adjectives in your description. So no matter how boring your B2B product is, you can make it sexier. I've written emails about VMware. I've made them sexy and funny and interesting. It can be done. If you can do it for VMware, you can do it for anything. So smell, taste, sound, touch, words like delicious versus taste good, they evoke emotion naturally. You don't necessarily need to write delicious in your cold email unless you're zero cater, but think about thinking outside the box and doing something different that stands out, that adds emotion and sensory details. Likewise, metaphors, the right metaphors, can work really well. You have to think about your audience, though. You have to think about cultural differences as well, because not everyone will know the same metaphors, especially if you're dealing with an audience that actually might have a lot of English as a second language learners, which many people are. And then finally, my last tip for writing great cold emails is to step back, take a walk, pause, go to sleep, have a drink, whatever, and look again at your copy later. Read it out loud. Ask yourself, how does it sound? Ask yourself, if I was the reader, would I read this? Would I respond to this? Take yourself out of your shoes and think like an anthropologist. If I knew nothing about my company and I didn't know me, I didn't know any of this stuff, would I give a shit? Would I respond? Would I stop what I was doing? If not, you need to do something different. So, I have one example. So just a couple fast examples, then we'll go into the templates. So here's a couple examples of more emotional, engaging copy. And so the first one is, our software provides bank-grade security, so you know your passwords are always as secure and protected as Fort Knox. It's a little cliche, but you get the idea of evoking an image and having a little bit more interesting emotional copy. Another one is, prevent customers from feeling let down and annoyed by making sure they never get ads that make them feel misled or disappointed. And then the next one is, our clients are enamored with us because they're seeing 6x higher engagements from ad campaigns that they otherwise thought were dead. So simple things like the word dead versus like inactive, add emotion and make your copy stronger and more persuasive. And the last one is, instead of having boring and poorly segmented campaigns, create laser targeted ad campaigns that are unforgettable. So before I go into the examples, does anyone have any questions? Yeah.
I noticed in a lot of your templates you reference like client X, assuming it's a brand. Would you always have a legal write-off or client X and whoever that was to use them, and assuming it was either a case study or something else, or was that just something?
I mean, ideally, yeah. So ideally, hopefully, you would have some clients you can mention. I realize not all new startups have that luxury. If you do not, you can describe them instead. So like, for example, if I was saying I did an email campaign for Zen Payroll, which is now Gusto, instead I could say a payroll software solution or something like that. And a lot of companies do have NDAs where you can't say it, so it's not uncommon. It's not as strong. But you can describe and allude, and if you can't say their name, that also allows you to have a little bit more creative license in the details. What I would say is, don't make things up that are not plausible, that you cannot actually do, but if you don't have exact numbers, and you have an NDA with this client, and you know ballpark what they are, I would say it's better to write a ballpark number that sounds tangible than say 50%. So, if you can say that you took it from this to this and you know it's approximately right and you can't say their name, take that opportunity to do that as long as it is plausible and along the lines of what really happened. I know there's some cases where you don't have exact data. I would rather do that and like have it be more effective as long as it's something you can actually back up, because at the end of the day, you have to think, okay, I get a response and I even close a deal. What happens if we can't deliver on these things we've talked about and the promises we've made and the examples we've given? You're setting expectations in your cold emails, so you don't want to make outlandish claims, otherwise you're going to turn those customers. That one, oh, sorry, you were raising your hand already, so yeah.
Could you elaborate more on how you select which emotions you want to target? Are there certain emotions which you target that work well more better than others?
Yeah, that's a great question. So it depends on the audience. I would say in general, fear and pain are powerful, but you have to be careful using them. So certain audiences are more delicate, and certain audiences handle aggression better or worse than others. So for example, you're targeting VP sales. They're much more okay with aggression, and they're much more prone to being susceptible to competition than, say, a CIO. Or like someone more technical and introverted. That's not always 100% true. There's always exceptions. And at the end of the day, you don't want to be a douchebag. But I would always be a little bit more delicate with more technical audiences than like VP sales. And marketing is somewhere in the middle between those two. So think about your audience. You can kind of see it a little bit in the content they share and what they write, and also the more you know your audience, you've talked to them, you can kind of get a feel. I would say the more you can surprise people or catch them off guard, the more you have a better chance of grabbing their attention, but you have to be careful, because if you're a douchebag, they'll mark you as spam and probably put you on my hall of shame. So don't do that. Yeah.
Yeah, so a lot of these examples have been for industry-specific emails, probably companies that are selling a product or service really meant for one, maybe two industries. It seems like targeting specific size of things, whether it's game development or not. If you're selling more of a commoditized product where you could probably have any company buy it, are you suggesting to have, you know, 15 to 20 different templates? Are you suggesting to go more towards kind of middle ground vagueness that could apply towards a lot? If that's the case, are you kind of saying, well, maybe target, instead of not industries, maybe just target positions? So here's a template for VP of sales, here's a template for the tech people, here's a template for the marketing department.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's a great question. The answer is it varies a lot. It depends on the company, it depends on the industry, and it depends on who you're targeting and what the use cases and value is. And so I actually just wrote an article, I think like last week or the week before on Inc. Magazine on my column. It's inc.com/author/Heather R. Morgan or something. You can Google it, but seven something or other. I can send it if you email me. But basically, to answer your question, if you're in a very commoditized space, you actually might want to be more personalized. That doesn't necessarily mean industry. I think at a bare minimum, you should always think about the title, because that will change the use case the most, usually, more than industry. Title, and then company size, and then industry, usually. But it depends. So the litmus test that I like to use is, what is the use case of your product or service for that audience? And where does it differ? If it differs between director of marketing and VP marketing, they're separate. If not, it's the same. So you don't have to, for every title or every scenario, write a million different templates. You just have to think, where is that line drawn? And you know, it's a moving target. Sometimes for certain features of your product, it could be together. Other times it needs to be separated. And so I think a good test is, if you're seeing you're getting a lot of people that are either responding negatively, not responding, or unqualified leads, maybe you need to hone in on your targeting more. But as far as personalization goes, I kind of take a different approach than most people, because as a former economist, I'm all about optimality. And so I actually don't, unless you are writing to, or you're selling to an audience with really large deals in a small market, I don't advocate writing one-off cold emails. I write one cold email a day for fun and for practice, but I don't advocate writing all your cold emails one-off like that, because not only is it inefficient and there's huge opportunity cost, but likewise, you won't have enough volume to be able to be data-driven and see the results.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Before, where I'll go and look at a company and I'll look at the top decision makers and I'll do a company-wide usage of what they do, and I'll try to throw in some personalization in there, except that takes 20 minutes and half an hour to do, when I could have made more generalized.
So to answer your question, the real way to do it is, I like to start out with minimum personalization, which I consider to be at least at the buyer persona, like title level. And then test adding something and see how much lift you get or not. If it moves the needle marginally or not at all, don't do it. If it does, and it's worth your time, and you do a cost-benefit analysis for the time and money it took you to do that, and you know, you look at your funnel in terms of how many responses, appointments, deals closed, do it. If not, don't waste your time.
So if you were to take both examples you have, uh-huh, the reason why I'm asking this question is, mm-hmm, because I'm mostly working with millennials, and if they were to receive this, it would be like salesy. It's like it's selling right away. Uh-huh. And this kind of wording would be something I would avoid.
Yeah. Talking to millennials. It depends on your audience. So yeah.
What kind of wording, what audience would that be?
I mean, these are all different examples, and I don't even remember what they're from. And this is obviously not one email. These are totally different personas and totally different kinds of products. And one of these might even be from web copy, as an example. So this really varies, but I mean, think of your audience and how your audience talks. That's the answer. So looking at Twitter, LinkedIn, whatever, forums they interact on, how do they interact and how do they talk? That's how you should be thinking. How would you write, if you're a millennial, how would you write to your friend? And obviously you have to have a certain level of professionalism in your email, but the more you sound like a human talking to another human, that's the way it should be. One more question, I'll go to the examples.
So some people some people advocate things like adding a client referral video or a PS client or send an email from like a title which is, you know, Sports Nike, like vice president or something, create titles. And what do you think about those kind of tactics?
I mean, it depends. So I think PSs can be great. Not necessarily in every single email, but if you do it right and its interest is different, it can make it seem more human. I tend to avoid links in most of my emails because they can distract from the call to action. It depends on the context of the email. If there's something that you need to reference in the context of the email, that's one thing, but I'm not intentionally putting like a bunch of links in every email. It's very link light because that also tends to seem more marketing and more mass. And number one, you can't assume they're gonna click on that link. Number two, if you're burying information in the link that should be in the email, you can decrease your chance of doing that. But even if they do click the link, there's many cases where people are clicking and it's decreasing their response rate because that landing page or blog post or guide or whatever is not that valuable, or it's misleading, or they think that they have all the information and they don't need to talk to you. So to actually have less makes it more likely for them to respond in many cases. But the answer to everything is test and see, because there's a million exceptions in cases where something that would never work in this situation works here, or vice versa. So test everything, try it yourself, see what works for your audience. And let's look at those email examples. Oh, one thing, yeah?
So you talk about being laser focused and about benefits, not features. And like I have a SaaS platform that has lots of different features. I've made the mistake of bullet pointing a bunch of features.
Yeah, definitely no bullet points in cold emails. One per cold email. There are certain examples where it's like peanut butter and jelly, and they sort of go together. Like, you know, talking about making something more efficient will probably save time and money, right? So it's sort of like that umbrella, like where it's all going together. But the idea is that every email is focusing on a different pain point, value prop, idea, psychology, whatever. And so you're spreading it out over the sequence and ideally putting the stronger ones earlier on to catch the low-hanging fruit. And then the people that are either stubborn or interested in various things will respond along the way. Okay, so let's look at some of these templates. So I'm gonna read them really quickly and then I'm gonna show you my feedback, talk a little bit about how I would change them. But for starters, after I read it, I want to ask you guys your feedback. And so I don't know what the subject line for this is, but it says, "Hi Arvin, I just read today's article in Reuters on Holler's $30 million Series B fundraising round. I'm reaching out to see how you and your team plan on investing in customer acquisition and growth in the coming quarters. My company," oh, I guess I should have blacked that out, but oh well. "My company, Talkable, has a platform that allows retailers, Shutterfly, Hotels.com, Crate and Barrel, to name some, to create and manage refer a friend campaigns. Would you mind pointing me to the right contact to discuss this initiative?" Any thoughts on this?
I think my first response would be like, "Oh, you're hitting us up just like everyone else who knows
them." Exactly. Yeah, well, yeah. Go ahead.
Different focuses in the same email. At first you're asking him how you're going to invest, and the second one you're asking him if you deploy him in the right direction, so it sort of makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, the whole like who's the right person thing is a tactic. I think it's one that should be dead, personally, because I mean, there's certain scenarios where you don't really know who that person and that role would be and it's justifiable. But for the most part, like, that tactic was created more than a decade ago when we didn't have LinkedIn. It's kind of unacceptable and lazy right now to do that. And so many people do it and it signals right away that you're like a lazy salesperson trying to sell them. So unless it's like something where you're describing a role where, you know, I'm looking for the person who is implementing your sales processes to something, something, like something not obvious that wouldn't just be like the same title every time. could be okay, but let's look at some of my info. So personalization in theory is nice, but the first sentence isn't as special. It's something that everyone sends as soon as you raise money. And so talking before about like, what are these people getting in their inbox and what are other people doing and you want to be different, you're saying something really obvious that you can find on Crunchbase or LinkedIn. It's not that great. And likewise, it's better to incept that information and not say it directly. So you know they just raised Series B. Yeah. Oh, you're basically saying, you have money, come spend it with me. Instead, why don't you incept the knowledge that they are going to have to grow fast to make a statement that would be poking at a pain point you know someone who just raised Series B has, or a goal they probably have. And without knowing a lot about this product, I can't really think of something off the top of my head. But my second point is that the whole benefit or purpose of, you know, investing in customer acquisition and growth is pretty generic and broad. And it's just, and the fact they said investing, it's kind of like, give me your money. And then third, it would be a lot better. I mean, they have some great companies that are working with them, but to have really clear social proof that was tied to results, where they could say, like, you know, our refer a friend tool has helped hotels.com increase their revenue by X. And, you know, I think we can do something similar. And then finally, the CTA is super lame. Stop doing the whole, like, who's the right person thing. It's been dead for years. Don't do it. Unless, like I said, there's some cases where it makes sense, but not many. Second email, talkable one again. Referral program for insert company name, hi first name. I'm looking to connect with the person who handles e-commerce at insert company. My company, Talkable, has built a platform that allows e-commerce apparel sites similar to yours, Tom's, Club Monaco, Saks Fifth Avenue, Adore Me, blah, 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 to create and manage refer-a-friend campaigns. This walkthrough is what a typical workflow would look like. If you are not the appropriate person, would you please point me in the right direction? So I'm not sure what the walkthrough thing is. I don't know if there was an attachment or something, but that was super confusing. My feedback is that the subject line is really generic. There's no benefit. It's just a feature. It's not very intriguing. It has the capitalization. The intro is super lame. It's tired. It's that overused tactic. It has nothing to hook you in. And it would be great to have a stronger, compelling benefit tied to that social proof to make it really compelling and tangible, rather than just talking about like a platform and refer a friend campaigns. And I have no idea what the walkthrough is. And then again, the CTA is not enticing. There's no incentive for me to respond to this. Any questions with that so far? Well, it depends on what you're offering. It ideally should connect to the message as a whole. So for example, if I cold emailed people and it was me from Sales Folk and I was saying, I have advice to help you get more responses, blah, blah, blah. My call to action might be to critique your emails or give you feedback on your emails or share some information on how we made our customers successful. So like here, if they had an example of what they did with Tom's, they could say, you know, do you have 15 minutes to hear how we were able to achieve this for Tom's and see if we could do the same for you, or any number of pieces of advice or insight or value. And I mean, you could have something as simple as, you know, do you think it makes sense for us to talk? Although that's kind of opening rejection, although you want to vary your calls to action so they're not the same every time. So somewhere in the sequence, I might have something like that. But let's look at email three. So email three says, do you think company's site could be converting 20 to 30% better? Hi, first name. As you think about growing company, have you considered video as one of the marketing tools? You're probably seeing that video is no longer an option, but a necessity for startups. It helps me tell It helps tell a memorable story that lures qualified customers, gets investor attention, and attracts top talent. If you're collecting user signups on company website, I have a video idea that can help increase web conversions by 20 to 30%. I'd be happy to share my idea with you and discuss the concept in detail. When would you have time for a 15-minute call? So this reminds me of one of my old email templates that I published, and I can see some tendency there. So there's some things I like about it, some things I don't, but subject line itself as a whole is too long. I feel like a big part of it would be cut off, especially if the company name was long, so I'd make it shorter. Partly the idea of having like converting 20 to 30% better just feels kind of spammy to me. I have like a weird sixth sense for subject lines. Obviously you should look at the data, but I have two sort of tricks that I use with subject lines. I like to make them a little bit weird, not every time, but when I can, I make them a little bit weird and unusual. And I like them to be a little bit mysterious. So I want them to have like a taste where they want to open, but they don't know everything. Or I want them to assume it's something else. So maybe even video on company X website could be interesting. Whether they have a video or not, you might think like there's something with a video that someone said something about. That's just off the top of my head. Second part is the intro sentence, the form of it isn't terrible. It's in sort of, it's a question that is relevant, but it feels kind of generic. It could be much more targeted. It could be much more probing. I don't know who they're targeting here, but I would try to go a level deeper. Go ahead. Yeah?
Why do you say that the 20 to 30% claim lacks credibility? Is it the number itself? Is it just?
I think it's because I've seen a lot. So I like to look at subject lines in my spam folder from time to time. And I've seen a lot of emails in the last 6 to 12 months that talk about like conversion and like percent in them. And I don't know, it might have worked in the past more, but I feel like just a lot of people have been doing that lately really aggressively. And so even the word convert just feels more spammy to me. Like, I'm not saying don't put it in your body, but as a subject line, I don't want to say don't do it completely because there could be situations where it would fit, but I don't know, something about it just, it feels spammy to me. It's like a weird sixth sense. But like, it has parts of things that are right. Like, but even if I was going to do it, I would have a specific percent. I would have like 27%. And I would probably just phrase it a little bit differently too. But then the other thing is that, so I would go deeper or a little more specific with something on the first sentence to hook them in even more. But I think it could be more powerful. Don't know who they're targeting, so I can't really say what that would be. And then I like the flow of the email, but I feel like the three sentences in the middle, especially the you're probably seen and the it helps tell, those two, I feel like they're kind of prescriptive, especially like you're probably seen that video is no longer an option. Rather than saying something like that, it's much better to show a powerful example. So instead of having like that paragraph, I would probably have an example of how I did something that really gave the kind of results I'm talking about for a client, because then it would make the rest of the email credible. What's missing from the rest of the email, which like I think the rest of the email could actually kind of work, would be that credible example that would make you believe it. And I honestly think this could get responses, but I think it could get a lot more if it did that. And when I said in here that 20 to 30% claim lacks credibility, it's because I don't have an example of how you've been able to do this before. If I can hear about how like you helped company X do this and this happened, that claim would be a lot more concrete. Whereas it kind of sounds made up, and especially I think it would be better for you to say like as much as 27%, it sounds more real. And then again, so like the CTA could be fine if it had that meat in there. I'm going to go into email four. So subject line, company's got a happy customer or two note. I can't decide, it's a weird subject line, almost weird enough for me to click on it. But it's kind of gimmicky and cheesy, but like, I don't know. I can't decide, honestly. It's the kind of thing where I would say test something, a few things against it, but it kind of caught my attention. And it says, do you know that after watching a video, 64% of viewers are more likely to become customers? And I don't just mean video product explainers. There's much more to video than that. One powerful format that is being overlooked by many startups is customer testimonial video. Viewers' trust level goes through the roof. Oh, I think that's misspelled. Oh, the roof, typo there. Whoever wrote that, R-O-O-F. After watching a well-done customer testimonial, because a testimonial is social proof. It's the reason why sites like Amazon, Yelp, and Glassdoor are so popular. I've helped organizations like Feeding America and Semester at Sea tell their stories, and I have a customer testimonial concept that I think would work great for company. When do you have 15 minutes for a short phone call so I can explain what I have in mind? So this definitely echoes some of the stuff I teach, but there's some things that could be fixed. So like I said, I can't decide on the subject line. It's a bit cheesy, but it's kind of weird and interesting. I don't know. The intro sentence I kind of like, although I might add like the company name as a custom insert so it feels like less mass right away, more personalized. Although I feel like the body, everything after that, all the way to the social proof or right before it, could be very condensed. So there's something you have to think about email. Every word or sentence you add can have a cost or a benefit. Every extra sentence or phrase in there that isn't necessary is detracting from them reading on. Obviously, you need to have enough in order to get them to really read it all and understand and respond and not be like, what the fuck did I just read? Excuse my language. But extra fluff is lowering your chances of having them finish reading and responding. So I think that the body could be way more condensed and a lot shorter, lighter, stronger. I also think that clear social proof, having the example of an amazing customer video they did for one of their customers and explaining or just painting a picture, telling a story, what that was like and the results it got and something interesting and unusual about it could be really, really cool. And then it would make the call to action really powerful. But for someone who's helping create really interesting videos and customer testimonial videos, which are telling a story, there's no story in here, which makes it less compelling and less credible because you're not showing that example of like, you know, think of the best customer story that was ever told, something really unusual, interesting, weird, and that can really capture someone's attention. That could even be in the subject line. Like actually, for example, go ahead.
So speaking of length, is there an ideal sentence length? It seems like maybe like 6 to 8 or 7 to 9.
Yeah, so I would say most of our emails are 3 to 5.5 sentences approximately. That said, you could go up to 7 and 8 in the right situation. Like if you're telling a really interesting customer case study in there that is just so gripping or something like that, and you have like a PS at the end or whatever, that's okay. But again, think of focusing on just one thing and think of that main purpose. Does every sentence or phrase in there support what you have and build it up? Or is it distracting or unnecessary? If so, cut it out because that's all that should be there. Does that make sense? Okay, I think we have like one or two more examples. So this one is so long. can you guys all see it okay? I honestly don't even want to read the whole thing. Can you just read it yourself? Let me know if you can't, I'll read it, but Do you guys want me to read this out loud? No, yay, I don't want to. Okay, so I think it's really interesting that they mentioned the White House and it's at the end of the subject line and the end of the email. Holy shit, put that at the beginning. Like, the fact that it's about the White House is really interesting. The B2B/B2Gov thing is kind of weird. I don't know who they're targeting, if that's like a common term. But put the White House stuff, like first name, invite to White House workshop. Holy shit, I'm gonna open that right away. And so the intro sentence is super self-focused. Orange is holding a workshop on Monday. I don't know who the audience is or if they know what Orange is. Maybe they do, but I would assume probably not. And then they have this giant ass, like multiple paragraphs in the body that could be cut way, 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 way down. They're not focusing on one thing. They're rambling all about themselves. And the stuff about the White House is like over halfway through the email. Why is that, and like what they're trying to do, the most exciting part in the social proof, why is that not higher up? Likewise, no lists or bullets in your cold email. It makes them look mass and you don't have focus. It looks like mass marketing. And then also the CTA doesn't really match the email. It's kind of weird. It feels like you're just inviting them and there should be a link, but then you want a call. It doesn't feel right. I feel like you're trying to trick me into a timeshare. So it just feels kind of pushy and questionable with the fact that we're inviting. If they had said something like, you know, we're only inviting a select number of people. I thought we should invite you because can we have a quick call to make sure that you would be a good fit? Or like inviting them as a speaker. But like, why do you need to have a call to be invited to a workshop that someone's cold emailing you about? It's weird. So there's sort of this mismatch here. Any questions about that, by the way?
Would you ever write anything that long? Would the person's eye just glaze over?
No, probably not. Well, let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, that's like that whole paragraph's a sentence, Jesus. Yeah, it's too long. I mean, you want to think they're probably on mobile. Like, if you have the most gripping email, like the email I wrote to James Altucher was a little longer, but it was weird and personal. Like I mentioned an article he wrote about Yasser Arafat 2 years ago and asked him a question about it. And I said some crazy stuff about my own experience in Arab Spring. And it was probably only half as long as this, but it was one of my longer ones. But it was super personal and interesting and gripping every part of the way. And I didn't want to take anything out, but this is super long. Yeah?
Just, I guess, generally speaking, what are your thoughts on how to include actual times to set up a call?
Oh, yeah, great question. That was one of the questions that was asked that I'll cover then, but I can mention now. So don't put in Calendly links or whatever. Wait till they respond. If you do, that looks mass and feels presumptuous and obnoxious. So slow down with all your calendar links until after. And as far as like saying specific times, I've seen that work and backfire, so the answer is test it. It is kind of a pain in the ass if you're mail merging and then you say this time and everyone says yes to it, so you have to kind of think about that. At least you're getting them to respond, but like you might lose some people if you say that, and then you can only have one person keep that time. So unless you want to do like dynamic fields with different times, you're kind of setting yourself up for some potential issues. So I generally don't put a specific time. I might say this week or within the next few weeks or something. Let's look at the last one and then final questions. So this one is, no problem, helping agencies speed up client HTML email reviews and approvals. I'm so-and-so, the president at Company X. I run the email design blog. Oh, shit. Oh, well, I totally did my slides last minute. Fresh in Box, which you might have heard of. One of the things I hear about from agencies such as yourself is that HTML email approvals with clients are often a pain. I'm reaching out to see if saving time and eliminating errors from miscommunications during the email campaign approval process is something that you're interested in addressing. if you're not the right person and there's someone else on at your company, grammar error there, that handles the email campaign approvals, please forward this email to them. Look forward to hearing from you shortly. So before I rip into this, feedback, thoughts, anyone?
Delete,
right? Yeah, so subject line sucks. The subject line is so long and awkward. It's not compelling or interesting. I don't think I would ever write HTML email in my subject line. There might be some weird situation depending on the audience, but I don't think I would. It's just like not fun. The intro is super self-focused. Too many features, not enough benefit, not enough value. Like, there's no social proof. And the whole purpose of why they're reaching out is pretty lame. Could be way more compelling. And also, even like, I feel like it's so like wishy-washy or hollow. Even the fact of how they said, one of the things I hear about from agencies such as yourself is that HTML email approvals with clients are often a pain. If you're gonna do something like that, say, hey, I was talking to the whatever title, which is similar to the title they're targeting, last week, and he told me that he was struggling with getting approvals to send his email campaigns, that he spent like more time getting approvals than actually creating them, and his campaign was delayed because of that. I was wondering, has anything like that ever happened at Company X? If so, I have a few suggestions on how to prevent it, like we did for so-and-so, and now like approvals take them no time at all. Do you want to have a quick call to hear how this could work at company? Something like that would be better. And like cut out all the shit that's just stupid pleasantries that you don't need. Like, I hope this finds you well. Looking to hear from you shortly, exclamation point, that's obnoxious. And you don't need to say, please forward them your email. If they want to, they will. If they're not the right person and they think you have value, they'll forward it. You don't need to tell them that. So, yeah. And then just a couple questions that were asked before. So I'm gonna brush through these really quick. Already answered the first one. Hot email tactics, I don't know what that is. unless the person who wrote that wants to elaborate on that, I'm gonna skip it. The most effective subject lines, I said, weird and interesting and very focused on the audience. Also, if they look like something they would get in their inbox already, like it's from a customer or someone important, without being misleading that you piss them off and they hit delete or spam, works really well. Creating urgency post-pitch from the call to action sign up for a perpetually free product. I'm not sure exactly what that means. Not sure if that's during the email or after the sales call, so I'm gonna skip it. How did you measure the effectiveness of an email and how long would you test it for? Response rate, positive response rate, appointment set, deals closed, deal size, deal cycle time, shorter, more money, faster, better. And I mean, you should always be monitoring it because something that works could stop working. So always be testing and monitoring. Cool email that got me the most responses. I've seen a lot of weird cold emails, I'm trying to think. probably one of my most effective mass campaigns was the one I did for the mobile gaming company I work for at 500. It was super strange and unusual. I said that I just came back from post-revolutionary Egypt and had some really interesting economic insights on the region. In terms of trends in gaming and mobile gaming. And I'm advising a few startups here in the space that are from the region that were leaders in web games that have moved to mobile. Would you like to have a call to see this report and or coffee? And people responded because they were like, what the fuck is this? This is really strange and interesting. I don't get an email like this every day, and like these could be really valuable insights that could make me a lot of money potentially, and no one else is going to be sending me them. So that was a really effective one. Not quite sure how you best engage users at a B2B SaaS company, what that means, pretty vague. How often do you follow up? 8 emails every time for a whole campaign, because a third of the responses will come from 5 through 8. And the best reply, not sure if that's like, I like cold emailing famous writers, and I love it when they reply because I like writers. So yeah, I've had some of those. And personalization and scale kind of went into, I like to think of the opportunity cost. So you want the point that is getting you the most responses from the most valuable people for the least amount of effort, and that's where you stop. So if some more effort and data enrichment gets you a lot more responses and a lot more money, do it. If not, don't do it. And that's the sort of the same thing for personalization at scale. Any questions? Yeah.
You mentioned 8 follow-ups. What do you
space them on? Yeah, so 1 email and 7 follow-ups. So approximately 4 days apart. 3 to 7 is okay. Depends a bit on your audience. And there's certain cases where, like the holidays, you might want to space it even further to avoid them being out of office, or say there were certain other seasonal timing factors of, you know, people are likely to be on other vacations or industry trade shows or things that would cause you to want to send more event and timing trigger emails, and even maybe specific event and timing triggered messages can affect that a bit. But in general, about 4 days apart, for a lot of audiences, it's worth testing at least 1 email on the weekend. Not for people that are more like HR that are very 9-to-5, but like for salespeople, for CEOs, we're on our phones all the time. We're living in our phones. The weekend is when we're in our inbox going through it, when we actually have time to respond. So yeah, other questions?
Question about the footer.
Yeah.
The confidentiality statements at old school.
Like, you mean like unsubscribe?
Yeah,
or
this is confidential information.
That's a good question. I mean, it depends on the industry you're in. I don't typically put that because it's not really confidential if it's unsolicited email. I don't think you can really hold anyone to that. I don't know if like there's certain things with HIPAA that you might just put that standard as an industry where it makes sense. Question? Yeah.
Yeah, so how are those 8 emails different from each other?
Yeah, so everyone is focusing on a different idea, pain point, topic. And so generally speaking, you want to start out with the strongest first, but you also want to be a little bit more vague and mysterious in the beginning if you're going to do it at all. So if you're going to do that or any kind of social engineering or flattery or anything like that, you have to do it in the beginning because you can't go backwards. You can't be like super direct and aggressive and then not. Doesn't make sense. So you start out, if you're going to start out, more indirect early, but enough information to make them want to respond. And then from there, you're getting more direct over time, and testing different messages. So you're having like, you know, maybe this value prop and that one and this pain point and this like idea and whatever. It depends on your audience in terms of how you structure it. But yeah. Mm-hmm.
What are the top 3 tools you use for your cold emails? It's like Grammarly or SendGrid.
That's funny. I'm actually a terrible speller, and I do have Grammarly. I'm the worst spelling copywriter, but I never thought of it as a cold email tool. So I'm not going to personally endorse 1 outbound email tool right now because there's so many different ones out there. But I will say this, and I try to be kind of unbiased, but you want to be sending your outbound emails through MailMerge, not MailChimp, who will shut you down if they catch you, not Marketo, because it wasn't designed for that either, and it will look mass and have way worse deliverability. But anything going through a MailMerge, like, I mean, yet another MailMerge is the free cheap thing in Google, but one of the many popular outbound email tools that has raised the most money recently would be a good option. And likewise, there's a number of different list building options. It really depends on who you're targeting, but I'll say this. You want a bounce rate 4% or less. 10% and up will screw you over and ruin deliverability. So a lot of different outbound list building tools can work better or worse for certain audiences. And in some cases for certain data, you might have to scrape it yourself or get people in the Philippines or India on Upwork to do that. You know what I really do like though? I love using eQuire. It's just one of those tools I actually really enjoy that if I'm on LinkedIn, it'll integrate with my Salesforce and MailChimp, and it's not getting their email, but it's just handy because it's just like there, and I can see who's in MailChimp and Salesforce already. It's just one of the things I use, but yeah. Oh, did someone, or did I imagine that? Maybe someone's stretching. And you, yeah. Yeah, great, yeah. So I'd say a good range for opens is between 35 and 75%. It really depends on who you're targeting and like list quality, product market fit. CIOs are way harder to get a hold of than like VP sales. So they're gonna be more toward like the 30 side. Whereas, you know, you can get a lot higher targeting VP sales or marketing folks. I would not obsess on open rates because they have a lot of false positives and negatives in them. But if you're getting like less than 30%, you probably have a deliverability issue. You should check your mail server settings. You should check your list quality. You should check how well you're targeting a lot of things. Response rate 10 to 30, 35%. And again, for the whole campaign, that range is based on the same things of product market fit, list quality, how difficult it is to get a hold of that audience, how commoditized your market is, all that stuff. And you want it higher, you can always test adding personalization, but some things are just not as easy to do in certain industries. Emailing CISOs is a lot harder than getting a hold of VP sales. Any other, yeah?
I have a comment and a question. The comment is on open rates. Mm-hmm. I send out an email newsletter that has a lot of links in it, and 30% of the people who click never open. They don't show up in the open rate. What happens is they don't bother to display images. They see the email, they go, I got this, and I don't need to display images, and they don't record it. And so a lot of the emails you're showing here today, I don't think people would be inspired to display images, you know, and that's how open rate is tracked.
Yeah, so that's why I said you shouldn't obsess with opens, because there's a lot of false positives and false negatives. You could be on mobile and have things, you could have tracking pixels fire that don't, Google parses inboxes. Likewise, you know, due to certain security settings, you would have people opening that aren't opening. So that range still holds. What the real number is hard to say. But you can extrapolate based on other actions like response or click. And that is the real thing you should be thinking about. And ideally, positive response rate and appointments that are other valuable actions and conversions, because otherwise, you can have people responding saying, F off, don't talk to me. And that's not something you really want to be, oh, this is a successful email. You're getting a lot of responses. And the email says, your husband or wife is in the trunk of my car. That's probably not an email you want to send. It's just getting responses that are negative. So, yeah.
And then my question was, looking here at your example, I was wondering if you've ever tested urgency in the CTA. And the example is, the email goes, I have this wonderful product or service that's going to make your life better. We're planning on taking on 10 to 12 new customers for this spring. And we want to have this done by December 1st.
I mean, I think it can work, but the reality is your urgency has to seem credible and it has to benefit the customer. And so if, you know, the timing's right, they really want it, and maybe they're people that are really motivated by fear of loss, it can work. But likewise, it can backfire because they think you're a douchebag and there's no reason. And so if there's a natural urgency, like, I'm in New York this week, do you want to meet? That's a natural urgency that makes sense, or something that's related to a timeline you know they have, like they have to take care of, you know, something before tax season. If they have a deadline you know that they have, you can play that up, or even like incept things into that that would make them think of that. But synthetic urgency that doesn't seem credible is super obnoxious. Any last I think we're good. Thank you, guys. If you have any questions, you can ask me after. You can email me at heather@salesfolk.com. Twitter is at Heather Rehan, R-E-Y-H-A-N, my middle name. And if you want more advice, check out the Cold Email Mastery course. So, and we have other resources on the website, but you can check out that bit.ly link as well. Cheers.
Thank you so much, Heather. This was amazing, and we actually are running a lot later than I thought. So let's just wrap it up. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming, and thanks, Heather, for an amazing presentation. Yeah.